Scripture lesson for today is from the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. Let me extend you an invitation. Over the next 3 weeks, I'm going to be preaching a sermon series on flourishing. I'll, of course, talk more about that in a few moments. And we will be using the book of Ephesians as sort of a scriptural jumping-off place each week. I'm going to invite some interactive participation in this sermon series. Again, I'll speak to that momentarily. But I would also invite you to read along in the book of Ephesians. Ephesians is, for me, just a beautiful book filled with poetic images of beauty that invite us to deep places in our relationship with God. There are 6 chapters. It's not a long book at all. I don't know what your current Bible reading may be in your life. Maybe you're not reading the Bible daily, and here's a good opportunity to maybe work toward that discipline if it's been a while for you. But I would just invite you to read a chapter a day from the book of Ephesians. Again, 6 chapters, they're not long at all. But if you will just do that along with me, I would just appreciate that as a way of us immersing ourselves in this beautiful book. Ephesians 1, 3 through 14 is our scripture lesson for today. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished upon us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we who were the first to set our hope on Christ might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So for the next 3 weeks, I am engaging in this sermon series entitled Flourishing. And so we are inviting your participation in this. You may remember last week, we even invited you to do some video selfies talking with us about flourishing. We would still like to invite you to do that, but right now I'm going to actually invite you to look to the screen behind us, and if all works as according to plan, we will have about 2 minutes, a little less than 2 minutes. You'll notice there's some background noise in some of these, and so we are working to perfect what we're doing. But I want you just to join with me in reflecting on the idea of flourishing. So what is flourishing to you? And so we have some folks who are going to help us out with that.
21 years ago, I was called to a mission in Bolivia. Began as a medical mission and quickly morphed into a foster home mission. The boys in the foster home have flourished. The mission is flourishing. The Mama Joanna house is finished and needs to be equipped, but that will happen this year. I think this is what happens when God calls you and you follow, and you will flourish. Thank you.
Harper, what do you think of when you think of flourishing?
Thriving and thriving.
Thriving, all right.
When I think of flourishing, I think of
flourishing. Ellen, what do you think of when you think of flourishing?
I think of my friends.
Yeah.
Moses could be the one that hit you in the first year and get you to know the joy that you get in that relationship. We were talking today about Psalms 51:10, creating the whole heart of God, and put a new and right spirit within me. It's that spirit. God allows the growth in your need, your flourishing that you flourishing in God. You're sure of that.
It seems like a combination of internal teaching, but also energy and spirit. And a servant minded type of enthusiasm and action.
So, thanks to those who were willing to do that. And I would encourage, we're actually going to ask a different question this week. And you hear how the background noise can pick up a lot of stuff you don't intend for it to pick up. So just a technical note, if you can have if you can do it in not a public place, that probably helps. But to have the telephone close to you. But if you're willing to do that, I really do want to invite you to think about that. We really are looking for 20 seconds. 20 seconds. Now we're not legalistic about that. These were different links. But we're calling them testimonies in 20, and it's something that we'll play with a little bit. But during this time together, I want to ask a different question. I want you to reflect with me a little bit about how has fellowship in the life of the church or in your family or wherever you've experienced fellowship, how has that been a blessing to you, and what does that look like in your own life? If you wouldn't mind telling us in 20 seconds, it can be your experience here at this church, your home church, if you're from another church, or again, whatever that means to you. If you could get that to us by Tuesday, we might be able to incorporate that in our worship next week. So again, we're asking you to help us with some interaction. If you look at your bulletin cover, these are pictures that were submitted to us. Actually, you see Dr. John submitted that picture with all the kids from one of the that he's been working with in Bolivia. We're also asking the question, send us pictures of flourishing. What does flourishing look like? If you can send us a couple of pictures or one picture next couple of days, we'll continue to add to our collage here on the bulletin, so you can help us to create our bulletin. Really kind of want these 3 weeks to be, to some degree, a time of interaction as we think about flourishing. I want to invite us to think about flourishing. Christopher Bealy, who is a scholar, has been at Yale. He's coming to Duke, so I hope I have a chance to meet him. He wrote a book on Christian leadership, and one of the things that he said that really struck me in that book, he said, the real measure of a pastor's effectiveness, the one true measure of a pastor's effectiveness, is the spiritual health and vitality of his or her congregation. And when I read that, I thought, wow, that sounds deeply profound. And I know as a pastor how easy it is to be pulled and pushed and run in a variety of directions all in the same day. And every now and then I'll think back on Christopher Bealy's words and try to remember to keep the main thing the main thing. Henry Nouwen once talked about how it's very easy for us to become slaves of the urgent at the expense of the essential. And I think we all can acknowledge how easy that is to happen. So as I think about this sermon series on flourishing, I have you in my mind. I think about your life. I think about your spiritual health and vitality. And I wonder how I can be helpful not only in my own faith journey, but how I can be helpful in your faith journey as well. So, as we think about flourishing, I want you to know that I am hopeful that this will be an opportunity for us to really live into the fullness of who God has called us to be. Now, there's a lot of information around on flourishing and human flourishing, and I found a lot of different kinds of descriptions. And as I've done a little research and just really trying to get my brain around this idea, so I've come up with my own definition. You don't have to embrace my definition. You can leave it here if you like to. It's my definition. You'll probably hear me refer to it from time to time. But I'm going to define human flourishing this way. I believe human flourishing is the realization of our full potential and capacity as human beings created in the image of God. Let me say that again. I believe that human flourishing is the potential of our the realization of our full potential and the capacity as human beings created in the image of God. And so as I think about that, I, I think about what it means for us to live into the fullness of who God has created us to be. And I have certain theological assumptions that guide my thinking. Now, you may or may not agree with my theological assumptions, but I want you to know where I'm coming from when I think about human flourishing. And so I have some theological models that sort of guide that. One of the basic theological assumptions that I would offer is that human flourishing is God's desire for humanity, all of humanity. God's desire for the people of Highlands. God's desire for the people of Upper Darby. God's desire for the people of Bolivia. God's desire for all people everywhere, every color, creed, nationality, and language. I believe human flourishing is God's desire for all of God's people. I also believe that human flourishing is God's gift in Christ. I believe it is not something we can accomplish on our own. We can participate with what God is doing, but I believe fundamentally human flourishing is something God provides. It is God's gift in Christ. I'll further say that one of the theological assumptions that guides my thinking is that human flourishing begins and ends in Jesus Christ. I believe it finds its origin, its exemplar, and its telos in Christ. It is grounded in Christ. We look to Christ as the one true example of human flourishing in its fullness, and Christ is the end, the ultimate end, the goal, the completion of human flourishing. And I would further say that human flourishing is not dependent upon accomplishments or accumulation or accolades. I don't believe human flourishing is tied to what we achieve. I don't believe human flourishing can be measured in material things. The last thing I would say is I believe that human flourishing is not a solitary pursuit. I believe if my understanding of human flourishing is only about me and about mine, then I have missed the boat. Because I do believe the theological assumption that started this conversation, that human flourishing is God's desire for all of humanity. And so my human flourishing will always be yoked to the human flourishing of others. Even as I began this conversation, I reflected on Christopher Bealy's words that the effectiveness of a pastor is best determined by the health and vitality and spiritual well-being of his or her flock. And so my ability to flourish is yoked to your ability to flourish, given that definition. So for the next 3 weeks, I want to simply invite us to think about flourishing, and I'm going to give sort of three subheadings to invite that reflection. I want us to think about human flourishing through faith, through fellowship, and through fruit. I have a bit of a poetical heart, so I like alliteration, and that seemed to work well. So, again, the video selfie I'm inviting you to send to us next week is on fellowship. I want you to help us think about fellowship. You can go ahead and turn that. Elizabeth will be fine. Thank you. So I want to invite you to think about faith with me for just a little bit this morning. Because I do believe, as I said, a theological framework that guides my thinking is that it begins and ends in Jesus Christ, and Jesus is the fundamental grounding of human flourishing. So in my way of understanding, anything that tries to do an end around Jesus is not going to bear the fruit or the experience of human flourishing. So I'll make the statement, the claim, theologically at the very beginning, that human flourishing begins and ends in Jesus Christ, and so it's essential for us to think about the importance of faith. As I look out amongst you this morning, I suspect that this gathering in this place on this Sunday is not so unlike the gathering in other places, in other settings, on this Sunday morning. And I suspect it is true that there's a wide variety in terms of our faith experiences even today. Some of you come into this place with your faith strong and resolute. You have a great confidence and assurance in your salvation. You have a deep and profound trust in God. And you are at a good place in your faith journey. And I celebrate that. Being in a good place in your faith journey is a place of joy and peace. And so if you are there, then thanks be to God for that. I also suspect that there are some of you here in this place who are not perhaps in that place of strength today. Maybe you're not as strong in your faith today as you were at some previous time in your life. Maybe life has beaten you down. Maybe there have been things that have challenged your faith. Maybe you have far too many questions and far too few answers, and so your faith is teetering a bit today. And yes, it's possible that you are here today and you are not a person of faith. It's possible that you are here today for any variety of reason and you have not received in your heart the good news of Jesus Christ in a way to claim that in a personal and real way. That is very much a possibility. And if that is the case for you today, thanks be to God that you are here, that you can be a part of this time of worship together. I think the very place where you need to be when you are struggling with your faith is among believers to worship. I believe being in a church gathering is the absolute best place you can be if you're struggling with your faith or if you are not a person of faith. So if you're here, we are honored by your presence. Thank you for being here among us. As I've said to you before, and I think it just bears repeating from time to time, I do want to be that pastor. So want to be that pastor that if you are struggling with your faith or if you don't even believe what you believe that Christians are supposed to believe, I want to be that pastor where you can come to me and we can sit down and have a cup of coffee, or we can meet in my office or in your home or wherever, and we can talk about that. And you will understand very clearly that I would not judge that in any negative way. I understand what the faith journey is like. I can't mimic your faith journey. We all have our unique faith journey. But please understand, I understand what it's like to have more questions than answers. I know what it's like to struggle with faith. I know what it's like to have joyful moments of peace and assurance as well. And so I want to be that pastor that walks with you in your faith in the way that I can be helpful. This morning I want you to think with me about flourishing through faith and the importance of faith. And I want to give you a very Wesleyan kind of view of faith and understanding of salvation. When I went before the Board of Ordained Ministry to be ordained as a deacon at that time in the United Methodist Church, if you were a preacher, you were ordained a deacon first before you were ordained an elder. And so it was my very first experience of being before the Board of Ordained Ministry, and it's a pretty much of a blur. I just remember one moment. I was sitting in this theology group, and there was the president of Pfeiffer College. His name is Chuck. I don't remember Chuck's last name. But I remember the very first question that anybody asked me came from Chuck, the president of Pfeiffer College. And he said, "Randy, tell us about Wesley's Via Salutis." That was kind of my response. I wasn't sure at that point in my ministerial life if anybody had ever mentioned the Wesley's Via Salutis, much less know what it was, or much less talk about it as I was being interviewed for the Board of Ordained Ministry. And so I laughed somewhat uncomfortably, and I said, "Well, you know, I don't think I've preached on that recently." And Dan Martin, who was the youth minister at the church I was serving, the four churches I was serving a number of years ago, so we had become friends. Dan was on the Board of Ordained Ministry, and he bailed me out. He started asking me specific questions within the Wesley's Via Salutis. It simply is Latin for way of salvation. So it was Wesley's understanding of salvation. I know that now. I can knock that question out of the park now. And I'm not going to go down through all the different bullet points. I don't want to get really technical and just kind of all the steps and stages. But I do want to talk about salvation from a good Wesleyan perspective, because I do think Wesley had some things that are valuable for us to know and to experience, and that helps us maybe understand our faith a little more. Whether you buy into Wesley's understanding or not, I want to share it with you today. One other memory I would bring to mind years ago, when I was preparing to go before the Board of Ordained Ministry to be ordained an elder, I was a part of what's called the RION group, R-I-O-N, Residence in Ordained Ministry. And we went to Duke Divinity School and met with Jeffrey Wainwright, a New Testament scholar. And Jeffrey Wainwright said something that I've always remembered. I don't remember anything else he said, but I remember specifically that he told this room full of preachers, United Methodist preachers, he said, "God is too big to fit in any one church tradition's basket." God's too big. No church tradition has the market cornered on God. But he went on to say, it's the responsibility of every church tradition to guard what has been placed in its individual basket. So in other words, we want our Baptist friends to be good Baptists, our Presbyterian friends to be good Presbyterians, our Episcopalian friends should be good Episcopalians, and good Methodists should be good Methodists, because we all bring something of value to the good of the church. And so for us as United Methodists, at the heart of our theological DNA is this profound belief and appreciation in God's grace. And we're not the only one that believes in God's grace, clearly. But it is very much within the fabric of our DNA. And we would define grace simply as God's unmerited favor. It is God loving us without us deserving God to love us. God loving us just as we are in the fullness of who we are. That's who God is. So this morning, I want to invite you to think with me a little bit about Wesley's understanding of how that grace works in our lives. Wesley would begin by understanding that within all of us, there is this seed that God has planted in our very created being, the seed of grace. Wesley would refer to it as preventing or prevenient grace. It is that grace of God that goes before. It is that grace of God that is wooing us, inviting us, bringing us in a Godward direction. Whenever we have an infant baptism in the United Methodist Church, I always like to reflect on how that is the most beautiful, tangible expression and representation we have of God's prevenient grace, Wesley's understanding of God's prevenient grace. Because that child doesn't have a clue what's going on, but God is at work in the life of that child in ways the child doesn't understand. I was talking with a friend of mine from another church tradition a number of years ago, and my friend said, well, you know, in our tradition, we don't do infant baptism. We just have believer's baptism because we believe you shouldn't be baptized till you understand what's going on. And my response, my good Methodist response was to my brother, I said, well, you know, if we wait until we understand fully what's going on, who among us would be baptized? It is God's mystery at work. So if you run into anybody who can explain fully the mysteries of God, take a couple of steps back. I think part of our faith journey is understanding there are some things that we cannot fully understand. But I believe in Wesley's understanding of prevenient grace, there's something of great value that even before we come to faith, God's at work. God's at work in ways we can't see and in ways we do not yet know. I was talking with a man years ago in another church setting. He was not in our church. He was a family member of a person in our church. He was in a hospital. He was very seriously ill. And so my parishioner said, would you go see my brother, I think it was. And so we went and we talked. And it was really just sort of a casual conversation, getting to know one another. He, of course, knew I was a pastor. And sometimes as a pastor, you're kind of invited to those kind of sacred spaces and conversations just by virtue of your role. And at some point, we began to talk about faith. He was not a person of faith. He did not believe in God. And for him, at the heart of that was he could not embrace intellectually this idea of a God who would love him unconditionally. The idea of unconditional love was such a stumbling block for him because he knew very much what conditional love felt like, right? We all know what it's like to live in a conditional world. So he really struggled with this idea, and so he just couldn't get his brain around that. And in a moment of, I believe, divine inspiration, I do think the Holy Spirit was working with this pastor in that moment. I heard what he said, and I tried to affirm what he was saying. Yeah, I get that. I mean, that's really hard to get our brain around. I mean, just the all-encompassing love of God, so I completely understand that. But I said, is there anybody in your life that you think embodies that? Have you ever experienced that? Could you point to that experience where somebody just loved you fully and completely? Without reservation, without question. You didn't have to earn it, and you couldn't lose it. And he thought for just a moment, and then very quickly he said, yeah, my grandfather. My grandfather loved me, and I knew my grandfather loved me, and even when I messed up, I knew he didn't quit loving me, and I remember my grandfather loved me unconditionally. And so we spent the next 10 minutes talking about his granddad. It was really beautiful. I was blessed to hear all the ways he had experienced unconditional love through his granddad. And after he had talked for several minutes and we were just kind of sitting there in that moment, I just reflected out loud. I said, you know, thank you for sharing about your grandfather. What a beautiful example of unconditional love. And if I could just invite a little further reflection around that, I would suggest that what would it be to imagine that God's love is even greater than your great grandfather who loved you so fully and so well? And I could see the wheels beginning to turn, and for some reason that began to make sense. It was something physical he could hold on to, something tangible that he could hold on to the mystery of the ages. And so I saw him sometime later. One more time I saw him. And he brought up the story of his grandfather, and he said, you know, I've been thinking about that ever since we visited. I've been thinking about my granddad, and I'm beginning to think that maybe there is a love that I haven't really been able to embrace, but maybe just thinking about my granddad is a step in that direction. Now, I don't know where his faith story continued or ended. Maybe it's continuing to develop. I'm not sure if that man's still living today. But I do think there are those people that God places in our lives that invite us into a Godward direction. Have you seen the documentary on Mr. Rogers? Yes, no? How many have? A few? So the rest of you, this is your assignment to go see the documentary on Fred Rogers and take you plenty of tissue and just plan to blubber. We were watching it, and it's tender, it's beautiful, it's sweet, it's about goodness and love and acceptance and all those kinds of things. And Kathy and I, we went to Asheville to see it, and when the movie ended, we were an absolute wreck. We were just a wreck. The last 10 minutes, I was just heaving and trying not to make so much noise. Of course, it would have blended in with everybody else's who was sniffling and sobbing. And not to sort of spoil anything for you, but there was a moment where we were invited in the documentary, we were invited to think about those people in our own lives who communicated the message that Fred Rogers tried to communicate to the children over the years. And that is that you are loved. You are loved, and you are cherished, and you are valuable in just who you are. It's called unconditional love. And as they were kind of talking about that in the documentary, my Aunt Jean came to mind for me. My Aunt Jean, I preached my Aunt Jean's funeral 10, 15 years ago. I don't remember how long it was. It was one of the high honors of my life. You've heard me talk about my Uncle Bob. Well, my Uncle Bob and my Aunt Jean were a couple. And so my Aunt Jean, when I was a child, she communicated that to me. My Aunt Jean, in her very sweet and beautiful way, let me know face to face, close down to my level, let me know that I was loved and I was cherished, and that I might make mistakes in life, but I would never outrun the love that she had for me. And so I thought of Aunt Jean as I was listening to this, and boy, I'm just all over the place, just sobbing. And I don't like to cry in public any more than any of the rest of you guys do. But there are just times when the heart gets so full, and you just can't contain all the love and the goodness in. And I say thanks be to God for those people in your life and in my life before you even knew about God's love, who modeled it for you, who loved you with an unconditional love, who loved you just the way you are, who would not give up on you, who would not desert you, no matter how many mistakes you made, because they loved you for you. So I think that's what prevenient grace does to us. It pulls us in the direction of God's love by giving us examples of that love in our life. And so as we believe, before we know it, God is pulling. God's at work long before we know it. And so in Wesley's understanding of the way of salvation, there comes that point in our growth in this idea of salvation. Wesley understood salvation not to be a one-time moment, but a whole lifetime, beginning before we even know it's happening. Leading all the way to glorification would be the word that he would use, being with God forever and ever. But throughout our life, we are working. God is working at us to save us from our sins. And that's what Wesley understood primarily when he talked about salvation, being saved from sin. So Wesley believed there comes that time, whether it comes in a moment or gradually over time, there comes that moment when you recognize there's something between you and God. It's called sin. something in your nature, something in your behavior, and you know that it's something that's not honoring to God, and there's that point at which over time, whether again in a moment or over time, you really begin to want to please God because you begin to respond to this unconditional love, this great love, and you want to somehow be better because you want to be better for God. Not so that God will love you or God will love you more, but just in response to God's divine initiative in your life. And so there's that point, however it comes, and you want to be rid of this darkness within you, this sin, and so you seek out God's forgiveness, and you recognize that God offers forgiveness in Jesus Christ, that what Christ did on the cross is effective to save us from our sins, and so you embrace that, and however you do that, you embrace that, and you say yes to Jesus in your own heart and life, and you recognize that not only did Jesus die to save the sins, to save the world from sins, but that Jesus died to save you from your sins. It was John Wesley's journey. John Wesley was a preacher, had been for a number of years preaching the gospel, preaching a very sort of legalistic gospel, perhaps, if you will. And then May 24th, 1738, you'll hear preacher types like me in the United Methodist tradition talk about Wesley's Aldersgate experience. May 24th, 1738, he'd been a preacher for a long time, but then he goes to this Bible study on Aldersgate Street, and he hears somebody reading this preface from Luther's preface from the book of Romans. It's about 9:15 at night, and then all of a sudden, Wesley believed. His heart was strangely warm. Here, this very deeply religious man, and now it wasn't just that Jesus had died for the sins of the world. Jesus had died to set John Wesley free. I felt my heart strangely warm. That's the way he said it. I felt that Christ did indeed die for me, and it saved me from the law of sin and death. And so it changed John Wesley in that moment. Now, he wasn't free from doubt after that. He still struggled with assurance and doubt and those kinds of things, but it changed his preaching because he experienced the love of God in a very personal, tangible way in the person of Jesus Christ. And so Wesley would describe that understanding as God justifying us through God's grace, God's prevenient grace, bringing us to that place of justification where we are set right with God. We are pardoned, forgiven for our sin through Jesus Christ, through faith in Jesus Christ. Wesley would go on to say that at that moment, whatever that moment's like for you, at that moment, God continues to work with us to bring us to a place of righteousness and holiness. Wesley would use the term sanctifying grace. He would talk about the fact that when we are saved from our sin, sin no longer reigns, but as we all know, it remains. If you come to God through faith in Jesus Christ, you are saved from your sin, but you also know that sin is still something that hangs around for a while. Now, it's very easy for us to just sort of buy into a generalized notion that, well, I'm a sinner, I'll always be a sinner. Well, that's not good Wesleyan theology, I'll tell you that. Now, you can certainly embrace that, but John Wesley would argue the point. John Wesley believed that through the grace of God working to sanctify us, we could get to that place in our life where sin not only didn't reign, but it no longer remained, to the point that we would never, ever do anything willingly that was a sin. We would be guilty of no sin intentionally. Wesley even used the term Christian perfection. We kind of shy away from that term a little bit simply because Christian perfection has that word perfection in it, and we know that nobody's perfect, right? Wesley didn't mean Christian perfection in the sense of being free from error or mistake or that your opinion would always be right. He simply referred to that as being perfected in love, that place where we would, again, never knowingly sin, that place where we would be habitually filled with love of God and love of neighbor. So this morning, as I bring to a close this reflection, I see it's 12:05, so I'm going to wrap this up here this morning and we'll move forward. I simply want to invite you over these next 3 weeks to join with us as we reflect on flourishing. I want you to flourish. I want you to be the fullness of who God has created you and intends you to be. I want you to know God. I want you to know God in the fullness of how God intends to reveal himself to you. I'm going to close this morning with a bit of scripture that I like to sometimes use as a benediction, but I'm going to close it with from the book of Ephesians. It's that beautiful word of blessing in the book of Ephesians. It's Ephesians 3, chapter 16 through 21. I simply want you to hear this word of blessing this morning. I pray that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit. and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we could ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever.